Thanks for watching Pongcast TV, keeping you in the loop for all things table tennis. Make sure to check out the website at thepongcast.com for the show notes. And while you're there, you can also subscribe by clicking on the link on the right side of the page so you'll be automatically updated when a new episode comes out. Welcome to this episode of Pongcast TV, episode 17. Thank you so much for joining me. I'm going to try to keep it short this week, so on the show, we'll just do some catching up on some table tennis sightings in pop culture and on TV over the past few weeks, and then we'll have some brief highlights from China's national championship and the first round of the Chinese Super League. Let's go! As you may have seen on previous episodes of Pongcast TV, I've mentioned how popular table tennis is among other pro athletes in other sports. We've seen tables in the locker rooms of sports teams like baseball and hockey, and how the players like to unwind and at the same time build some camaraderie in between practices. And now you can also count golf as yet another sport where table tennis has taken off. The Ryder Cup took place 2 weeks ago, and this event pits some of America's best golfers against Europe in a team format. During that time, there were many articles and clips on the event, and you probably heard the golfers talk about table tennis just as much as the actual golfing. Here's Phil Mickelson himself, who describes how the game brings the scene together.
It's been a lot of fun. We've had a lot of fun together as teammates. I think we have had we've had not much success together on the course, but I will say that as partners on the Pong table, he and I are delivering. We are serving it up, and there are not many guys that can match us on the Pong table. So although we didn't play well together in 04 on the golf course, put us together on that table, and we're rocking it.
And here's yet another tournament where the players were picking up a paddle, but this time it was against U.S. Olympic table tennis team member Timothy Wong, who showed some of the best pro golfers in the world how the pro table tennis players do it at the 2012 BMW Championships that were held earlier in September. The past few weeks of television have been pretty good for table tennis, with the sport making several appearances. Here's another U.S. Olympic team member, Ariel Xing, making her second appearance on the Ellen DeGeneres Show. As you may remember, she had one of the most memorable matches of the Olympics, when the 16-year-old high school student nearly upset world number 2 seed and eventual gold medal winner Li Xiaosha from China. One of Ariel's acquaintances, none other than Microsoft founder Bill Gates, also made an appearance that day just to watch her match. The name dropping doesn't end there. When Ariel was asked to play former Friends star Matthew Perry in Ellen's place just a week ago. And as you may see, Matthew Perry actually isn't too bad as a casual player. That might have to do with his upbringing when he played tennis pretty seriously as a junior. I'd like to see him play a few times a week maybe. I think he'd be actually pretty good. And here's yet another table tennis Olympian. This time it's Dmitry Ovtcharov from Germany. Of course, Ovtcharov had an incredible Olympic run, winning a bronze in the team event and in the singles. And here he gets to make an appearance on a German morning talk show. Now, I don't know any German, but if you're German or you know German, check out the show notes. I've got a link to the clip. You can watch the rest of it in its entirety. And please leave a note in the comments and let me know what they're talking about. And finally, the reality game show The Amazing Race sends contestants around the world going from one exotic city to another to compete in some unique contests. One of these stops took place in Shanghai, China, where the only goal was to score 1 point against a 10-year-old junior champion. If the contestant was not able to score, the junior champion would switch from a paddle to using random objects like clipboards and frying pans to help even the playing field until the Amazing Race contestant could finally score.
He's like, I'm going to play you with the paper side. I'm not even going to use the flat side.
Come on, James. It's got to be the 10-year-old. James, you got this.
So I got dusted with a clipboard. I just sit here and eat my piece of humble pie.
China's national championships recently concluded, and even though it is obviously limited to Chinese players, you could easily argue it's one of the toughest tournaments of the year. Now, I primarily focus on men's singles just because of time limitations, but I have to mention this incredible mixed doubles match at the Chinese National Championships. When you have arguably the best male and female players on the planet teaming up, you probably expect them to win it easy. But Ma Long and Ding Ning had their work cut out for them in the finals against a team of Zhe Yiming and Cheng Chenchen in a nail-biting 7-set finals. In doubles, if you can find a good match of strengths and weaknesses, plus great chemistry and teamwork, you can make up for the difference in a lot of ways. And the team of Jay and Chang did just that. They pushed the limits of Superman and Wonder Woman, but ultimately fell short 13-11 in a thrilling final set.
13-11, 马龙丁宁经过七局两分的优势拿下了全国乒乓球锦标赛。
Now, as for the very tough men's singles draw, who would you pick to win it? Rule number one, Zhang Jike. Rule number two, Ma Long. Rule number three, Xu Xin. Rule number four, Wang Hao. Rule number six, Ma Lin. Rule number nine, Wang Lichin. If you picked any of them, you'd be dead wrong. None of them even made it to the finals, showing just how flush China is with world-class players. How tough is it when you've got six of the top 10 players in the world and none of them survive? Instead, we've got Zhou Yu and Fang Bo in the finals. Zhou Yu made his ITTF debut in stunning fashion by making the finals of the Russian Open just last month before losing to Xu Xin. And we've seen Fang Bo in a handful of Pro Tour events, a sure sign that he's on the shortlist to be one of the next Chinese A-team members. US fans may also remember his appearance at last year's North American Teams Tournament, and here he was playing against US national champion Peter Lee in 2011. Now to get here, Zhou Yu defeated Ma Lin, Yanan, and Zhang Jike. And on the other side of the bracket, Fang Bo, he had a little bit of an easier road when Ma Long had to drop out. And Wang Lichin and Wang Hao were also knocked out in the early rounds. That's just further proof of the sheer amount of world-class players in China at any time. In this match, we get a clash of styles that actually reminds me of Ma Long and Zhang Jike. Fang is a more balanced attacker, and he looks like he's willing to go for aggressive shots anywhere. And Zhou, he's got a really strong backhand attack, plus, as you see in this match, he's got great control and blocking to set himself up.
哎呦，漂亮！说我们乍一看啊，就是从这个两个小将的肌肉类型来看，底线长球，好的，形成对拉，硬拼了。周宇反手拉，周宇还有反手再发力，侧身，再用反手发力拉，继续发力，啊，侧身，哎，又来了。
Zhou Yu was not even one of the high seeds in this tournament, but he managed to survive the gauntlet and knock out Fang Bo in the finals convincingly 4-1, with a runner-up finish at the Russian Open. And as a big winner at China's national championships, Zhou Yu has suddenly burst on the international scene as yet another serious threat, not only to the rest of the world, but maybe even more importantly to the Chinese team, where players are always fighting to get a spot on the A-team or to keep it. As you know, I'm a huge fan of dominant backhand players, and add on his early success in his career, I can't wait to see how he does in months to come. He will definitely be a player to keep your eye on in the future. And finally, the Chinese Super League kicked off the first round of play last week. It's a league consisting of 8 teams, featuring all of China's best players, making this the toughest league in the world. And as most professional sports leagues do, they typically start off their seasons with a big matchup that everyone's really excited to see. And this highlight comes from probably the single matchup that's dominated table tennis for over a year. Powers collide when Ma Long's team Ningbo faces off against Zhang Jike's team Shandong. Ningbo has to be considered the odds-on favorite to win the title, as they also add Yanan, and Korea's Ju Si-hook as teammates. But John Jiku scored the instrumental first point for his team when he defeated Ju Si-hook. Next, Ma Long defeated Fang Bo to even it up, and then Ningbo took the lead 2-1 after the doubles match. This set up the pivotal fourth match between Ma Long and John Jiku, but with a quick team format, they were obviously fighting fatigue on top of battling each other.
拉起来，形成相持，胆量很大，一旋转，形成对拉。您正在收看的是。
Ma Long would take the lead 2-1, and he actually led many times in the fourth set. But John Jiku is one of the best players at making comebacks, and he did just that to force a fifth set. To make things even more dramatic, the Chinese League changed the rules in order to expedite matches for TV time. So the fifth and deciding sets are only played to 7 points, and you must win by 2. While 11 points already puts a premium on every rally, there's an even bigger amount of suspense on every shot in the final set. John Jiku prevailed this time in this intense rivalry, and his teammate will win the next and final deciding fifth match to give John Jiku's Shandong the upset victory. If you want to see any of these videos in their entirety, check out the show notes for this episode on my website at thepongcast.com. I'd love to hear your comments and ideas. You can follow and contact me on Twitter and Facebook, as well as email me at thepongcast@gmail.com. Thanks for watching.